presenters not to exceed this 10 minutes presentation period. And finally, I kindly ask the presenters to briefly introduce themselves for the audience and other participants. Now, let's start the first presentation. I want to call upon İlkay Çelik to present with his presentation entitled as the application areas of nanotechnology in food industry. Yes, Mr. Çelik. Mr. Çelik, can you hear us?
Okay, oh, yes.
Yeah. You can start now.
Thank you. I'm trying to share the screen. Can you see my presentation?
No, we can't see now.
Can you see right now?
Yes. Okay. It is okay right now.
Firstly, I want to introduce myself. I'm İlkay Çelik. I'm a doctoral student at Selçuk University Department of Food Engineering. My topic presentation is the application areas of nanotechnology in food industry. I'm going to talk about introduction, nanotechnology in food industry, potential adverse effect of nanotechnology applications, and conclusion. Introduction. The word nano is derived from the Greek word duor. A nanometer is 1/1,000,000th of a meter. Generally, word of nano mentions a size scale between 1 to 100 nanometer. Nanotechnology is a branch of science and technology that involves the characterization and production of structures or materials that have at least one dimension that is smaller than 100 nanometer in length. Nanotechnology can apply in many fields such as food, medicine, biotechnology, agriculture, pharmacology, electronics, defense, textile, machinery, and construction industries. Nanotechnology in the food industry is a rapidly developing field with various applications in food analysis, food processing, and food packaging. Nanotechnology in the food industry. Nanotechnology has been successfully applied directly into food or packaged food products for food fortification, food quality, and for food safety, food improvement, extension of shelf life, and production of antimicrobial food packaging. Nanotechnology applications in the food field can be grouped under four topic titles. Food processing and development of functional products, transport and control release of bioactive substances and nutraceuticals, detection of pathogens and improving food safety, developing of food packaging systems, food processing and development of functional food products. A main focus of nanotechnology applications in food is the development of nanostructures food ingredients and also delivery systems for supplements and nutrients. The principles of nanoscience are to develop encapsulation systems that improve the stability of food and also protect sensitive bioactive substances from the environment and prevent undesirable interactions during food processing and prevent food quality degradation during storage. Nanotechnology enables antioxidant nutrients and proteins to reach a specific part of the body and cells more effectively and efficiently, thereby increasing efficacy and bioavailability. Therefore, nanotechnology makes possible the enrichment of food products and the and the development of new products. Emulsions have potential advantages than conventional emulsions than special applications in food and beverage products. One of the most important advantages of nano-emulsions is that they can be incorporated into clear and slightly turbid products without changing their visual appearance. Nano-emulsions also generally have better stability against particle aggregation and gravitational segregation. Oil and water nano-emulsions consisting of oil droplets dispersed in the aqueous phase have the greatest potential for application in commercial products. Nano-emulsions are an important system developed for the transport of bioactive products by preventing sedimentation and creaming thanks to nanodroplets that make them appear transparent. Transport and controlled release of bioactive substances and nutraceuticals. With the nanoparticle produced through nanotechnology applications, the desired texture and aroma can be given to the food. Thanks to the edible film, antimicrobial packaging, biodegradable materials, and safety and shelf life of food can be secured. With intelligent packages and nanosensors, indication of spoilage in food can be detected in advance. Hydrophilic substances become fat soluble and lipophilic substances become water soluble because of nanotechnology. So some functional components such as carotenoids, phytosterols, and antioxidants dispersed within water or juices and developed bioavailability of nanoparticles. The bioavailability of carotenoids is quite low. Because of their high hydrophobicity, carotenoids are insoluble in aqueous systems and therefore have a poor uptake in the body. Micro and nano dispersions have been developed to improve their water dispersibility, coloring strength potential, and also increase their bioavailability. Because of their high bioavailability, they have attained interest as delivery systems for bioactive substances such as carotenoids, polyunsaturated fatty acids, phytosterols, and lipophilic vitamins. The one of main detection of pathogen and improving food safety. Main applications of nanotechnology in food engineering is food nanosensors. During food processing, nano-based sensors are used to track products and detect pathogens or chemical contaminants that cause food spoilage. For this purpose, simple, recyclable, low-cost, and highly sensitive carbon nanotube-based biosensors that do not require labels have been developed. Nanosensors are placed directly into the packaging material where they detect metabolites released during food spoilage in a short time and provide information about whether the food is safe to consume or not. The working principle of the portable, low-cost, and non-specialized nanosensors is to place a specific protein of the microorganisms, which is characterized characterized as a bioagent on a chip, and the target microorganism in the food sample binds to the protein. Development of packaging systems. Packaging has an important place in meeting the food industry and consumer needs. Consumers' expectations from food packaging have increased in parallel with nanotechnological development. Packaging designs have been made using nanomaterial and nanocomposite in food packaging. Nanomaterials are divided into three categories: nanoparticles, nanofibers, and nanoplates. Nanoparticles consist of aqueous size particle of different shapes, such as nanogranules, nanocrystals, nanospheres, and nanoclusters. Nanoparticles stand out with their mechanical, optical, and antimicrobial properties, as well as important barrier properties. Nanofibers are nanomaterials of nanometric thickness and with both of micro or millimeter length. Example of which are nanotubes, nanorods, and nanowires. Nanoplates are disc sheets or nano.
Ms. Çelik, we have 2 minutes left for presentation.
Thank you.
Okay. Nanoplates are disc, sheet or plate-like materials with only one dimension nanometric and the other two dimensions quite large. Nanocomposites can be used as an alternative to existing polymer and polymer alloys. Nanocomposites used in food packaging are expected to be resistant to various stresses during processing, distribution, and storage. Active, smart, and biodegradable packaging designs are realized with nanocomposites. Potential adverse effect of nanotechnology applications on the health. It's quite difficult to predict the long-term effects of any technology such as nanotechnology. Although the potential benefits of foods produced by nanotechnology are highlighted, there is no knowledge of the safety of these products. Therefore, there are concerns about its effects on health. Recently, some researchers have carried about studies on the toxic effects of nanotechnology on biological systems and determined some potential effects. Nanomaterials such as silver, zinc oxide, and potassium and magnesium integrated into packaging materials can contaminate foodstuffs by direct contact. And when these products are consumed, they are pose a risk to human health. Conclusion, nanotechnology can be applied in many fields and is considered as the most important technological application of our age. The applications of this technology in the food industry provide many benefits such as developing new products, increasing the nutritional value of foods, detecting pathogens, using smart packaging instead of traditional packaging methods, encapsulating some functional ingredients, adding in beverages and increasing bioavailability. However, there is not enough scientific data on the risk of consuming foods enriched with nanoparticles, and this situation causes concern for consumers. For this reason, it's thought that the researches can be increased and these concerns can be overcome by some scientific regulations. Thank you for listening.
We thank Mrs. Çelik for her presentation, and we proceed to the next presentation without any question. The second presentation, I want to call upon Mrs. Masitova to present her presentation entitled as Manufacturing of Acidophilus Milk with Mayer's Milk. Yes, Mr. Masitova. Mrs. Masitova, can you hear us?
Yes. Can you see my presentation?
Yes, we can see. You can start now. Okay. You have 10 minutes. Uh-huh. Thank you.
Okay. Hello, everybody. My name is Açıruk Macitova, and I'm an assistant professor at the Department of Food Engineering at Kırgız Türkmen Manas University. Title of my presentation is Manufacturing of Acidophilus Milk with Mayer's Milk. At first, I want to introduce about Acidophilus Milk. Acidophilus Milk is a fermented milk produced by growing the bacterium Lactobacillus acidophilus in milk and used in medicine to alter the microbial flora of the intestinal tract under certain conditions. And Mayer milk is the main food in cuisine of the Central Asian people, but it hasn't used for many purposes, and the Mayer milk used only for the production or manufacturing of khmer. And the aim of our purpose study research was to increase the dairy milk product species and increase the range of dairy products made with Mayer's milk and increase the biological value of Acidophilus milk by adding Mayer's milk, because the Mayer's milk has a high biological value. Mare milk has a neutral acidity. It's fresh and has a sweet taste that ranges from bluish white to white coloration. The basic chemical composition and the bioactive compound content in mare's milk are different from cow's milk, but are very similar to human milk. And the protein fraction is particularly rich in whey protein. The lipid content is rich in polyunsaturated fat acids, and there is a high vitamin C content. Therefore, current research focuses on creating a milk similar to mare's milk and then combining it with milk of other species. Mare's milk possesses immunoglobulins, lactoferrin, and lysozymes that show high biological activity, which benefits the human body. And also, it's believed that mare milk can be used for the treatment of some diseases such as tuberculosis, chronic hepatitis, gastric ulcer, duodenal ulcer, intestinal infections for rapid recovery after surgery, skin rash, psoriasis, sunburn, and used during stress and chronic fatigue. In this table, we can show the comparable gross composition of mare, cow, sheep, goat, and human milk. If we compare the gross composition of this milk species, mare milk contains fewer calories and less cholesterol than those of cow milk due to especially to its lower lipid content. We can show the lowest lipid content here. And the low fat content of mare's milk makes it an ideal low-calorie alternative for people on reduced calorie diets. The lactose content of milk is mare milk is the highest compared to other milk species, it's similar to human milk and higher than that in ruminants, indicating that mares and human milk are quite similar. Mares and humans' milk are poor in mineral salt content when compared to ruminants' milk. Gross energy supply of the mare's milk is clearly lower than of human milk, which is comparable to the ruminant's milk. For this research, we used different types of milk species. To produce acidophilus milk based on mare's milk, we used the goat milk, cow milk, and the dried cow milk at different compositions. And as a starter culture, we used the Lactobacillus acidophilus from the Leofast LA SACCO system at a concentration of 0.014 gram per liter. Fermentation conditions was at 37 Celsius degree for about 13 hours. Methods used for the chemical composition was by the Association of Official Analytical Chemists. The content of the total dry matter, fat, protein, pH, titratable acidity, and the ash content was investigated. For the rheological measurements, we used the modular compact rheometer MCR-302, firm of Anton Parr, Germany. And as I mentioned above, samples to the produce of the acidophilus milk based on mare's milk, we used it with different compositions with other milk samples. Generally 36 sample types were manufactured using mare's milk. The first 12 samples were made with mare's milk and the powdered milk at different ratios, as you can see at on this table. We added calcium chloride for the acidification of casein of milk samples. The calcium chloride was added at different concentrations, and in some samples that was not added. Another 12 samples were made with mare's milk and cow milk, and another 12 samples were made with mare's milk and the goat milk at these different combinations. And as you can see from the table, also were added calcium chloride at different concentrations. The mare's goats and the cow's milk use the hexaflorane chemical composition. The dry matter fat content, protein content was higher in goat milk and is the lowest in mare milk. Acidity of mare milk was the lowest in mare milk and is the highest in goat milk because of the higher highest content of mineral content. And on this table, you can show, you can see that pH, the table acidity, and the whey percentage of Acidophilus milk samples. Titratable acidity was the main criterion on the selection of the samples for the further analysis. We can, from this table, you can see the red colored samples. These samples were selected as the best samples, and only four samples were selected from 36 samples. And in some samples, you can we can show the fractionation of whey proteins. And these samples were not selected because of the this type was is not best view of the sample. And only four samples, as I mentioned above, were selected. They were samples number 6, 10, 22, and 13. And also their chemical composition also was investigated. Comparative analysis for the comparative analysis, and as you can see, the acidity of all samples was the higher from 76 Celsius degree, which is a great criterion of the standards. And all samples, all selected samples contained 0.1 molar of calcium chloride, calcium chloride concentration. Results of the serological measurements showed that all milk types, milk samples have a Newtonian flow behavior with the highest viscosity of goat milk, afterwards cow milk, and with the lowest viscosity with mare's milk. And the rheological measurements of the Acidophilus milk samples showed that all samples are share thinning flow behavior according to this, according to the plot of share rate viscosity plot. And according to the share rate share stress plot of the Acidophilus milk samples, we can make a conclusion that all samples are taxotropic flow behavior with the highest hysteresis area.
Mastova, we have two minutes left.
I'm finishing. Okay, I'm finishing also. And as a conclusion, what can we say? We can say that high content, sugar content in mare's milk is what attributes to its high caloric content and is to undergoing lactic acid fermentation. High nutritional value of mare's milk provides best quality of fermented dairy beverage Acidophilus milk and also products made from mare's milk. And results of the study showed that the technological suitability of mare's milk to produce fermented milks and Acidophilus milk. And based on the results of the study, we can conclude that the milk samples can be manufactured by the mare's milk. Acidophilus milk can be manufactured by Acidophilus or by mare's milk. Thank you for your attention. Okay, I'm finished. Your microphone is turned off. Hasancan, your microphone is turned off.
Thank you, Ms. Mazdova. We thank Ms. Mazdova for her presentation. And we proceed to the next presentation without any question. Now, I want to call upon Mr. Ömer İpek to present with his presentation entitled as Black Garlic and Biological Activities.
Merhaba, kolay gelsin. Bugün siyah sarımsağın biyolojik aktiviteleri hakkında sizlere bir sunum gerçekleştireceğim. Siyah sarımsak geleneksel ve modern tıpta kullanılan popüler bir gıda ürünüdür. Sadece güçlü ve kendine özgü bir tada sahip olmakla kalmayıp aynı zamanda içerdiği allisin, dialil, disülfür, dialil, disülfür gibi biyoaktif bileşikler bulunmaktadır. Bu nedenle sarımsak antikanser, antioksidan, antibiyotik gibi çeşitli sağlığa yararları literatürde önemli bir şifa kaynağı olarak bildirilmiştir. Siyah sarımsak piyasadaki en fonksiyonel ürün olarak sarımsağın bir türevidir. Çiğ sarımsak ile karşılaştığında siyah sarımsak tipik bir siyah renge, tatlı bir tada ve rahatsız edici koku içermeyen çiğneme dokusuna sahiptir. Ayrıca siyah sarımsak antikanser, antiobezite, hipolipitik, antioksidan, hepatotropik ve nörotetik etkileri dahil olmak üzere çeşitli biyoaktiviteler olduğu tespit edilmiştir. Siyah sarımsağın üretimi konusunda yüzyıllar boyunca Tayland, Güney Kore ve Japonya gibi Asya ülkelerinde insanlar geleneksel bir gıda olarak siyah sarımsak üretimi ve tüketimini gerçekleştirmişlerdir. Ancak son yıllarda küresel pazara giriş sağlanmıştır. Siyah sarımsak taze sarımsağın tamamının yüksek nem ve sıcaklıkta fermentasyonu ile üretilmektedir. Bu da sarımsağın Maillard reaksiyonu, fenollerin oksidasyonu ve karamelizasyonu gibi bir dizi enzimatik olmayan esmerleşme reaksiyonu zorluğuyla siyaha dönüşmesiyle sonuçlanmaktadır. Sarımsak fermentasyona uğradığında sadece sarımsağın fizikokimyasal özellikleri değişmekle kalmayıp aynı zamanda biyoaktif bileşiklerin konsantrasyonu da artmaktadır. Sol taraftaki resimde gördüğünüz gibi siyah sarımsağın üretim sürecini göstermektedir. Choi ve arkadaşları çalışmalarında sarımsağın neminin ve pH fermentasyon süreciyle azaldığını, buna karşın indirgen şeker ve toplam asitliğin arttığını bildirmişlerdir. Bunun yanı sıra siyah sarımsağın renk spektrumlu ve aminoasitin bileşimi de taze sarımsağa göre değişim göstermektedir. Elde edilen sonuçta siyah sarımsak elastik ve çiğneme gerektiren bir dokuya sahiptir. Ayrıca rahatsız edici sarımsak tadı içermeyen tatlı bir yeni tat oluşmaktadır. Ayrıca siyah sarımsak taze sarımsağa kıyasla polifenol, flavonoidler gibi bileşikler açısından ve antioksidan bileşiklerin değerleri artmaktadır. Siyah sarımsağın tedavi edici etkileri, antikanser etkisi. Dünya çapında önde gelen ölüm nedenlerinden biri kanserdir. Vücudumuzdaki hücre ve dokuların kontrolsüz ya da anormal büyümesinden kaynaklı bir hastalıktır. Son yıllarda siyah sarımsağın antikanser etkisi olduğu bildirilmesine bağlı olarak bazı araştırmacılar siyah sarımsağın mide kanserinden lösemiye kadar kanserleri önlemek ve tedavi etmek için öğünlerde kullanabileceğini öne sürmektedir. Siyah sarımsağın farklı kanser hastalıklarında antikanser etkileri mekanizması, apoptozun intikasyonu, hücre döngüsünün durdurulması, tümör büyümesi ve istilasının invasyonun sonucu çeşitli mekanizmaları engellediği ortaya konulmuştur. Wang ve arkadaşları çalışmasında siyah sarımsağın sulu özütlerin insanlardaki mide kanser hücre dizisi olan SGC7901 hücresinin apoptozun doza bağlı bir şekilde tetikleyebileceğini öne sürmektedir. Ayrıca siyah sarımsağın tümör taşıyan farelerde tümörün büyümesi üzerine engelleyici etkisinin bulunduğu tespit edilmiştir. Dong ve arkadaşları yaptıkları bir çalışmada siyah sarımsağın kolon kanser hücre dizisinde üzerindeki antikanser etkisi gösterdiği bildirilmiştir. Bunun yanı sıra siyah sarımsağın alkol özütü ile tedavi edildiğinde HT29 insan kolon kanser hücre hattının hücre döngüsünü durdurabildiği tespit edilmiştir. Disitabi ve antiobezite üzerindeki etkisi. Obezite batı ve gelişmiş ülkelerde çeşitli metabolik sendromlara ve kronik hastalıklara neden olan halk sağlığını tehdit eden önemli bir sorundur. Obezite fiziksel aktivite, enerji alımı ve harcaması arasındaki sağlıklı beslenme dengesinin bir kombinasyon ile önlenebilmektedir. Siyah sarımsak belirgin bir lipid ve ağırlık düşürücü bileşen olarak belirtilmiştir. Chen ve arkadaşları siyah sarımsağın metanol ekstraktının antiobezite etkisinden hem adipoz dokuda hem de karaciğer, lipogenez, adipokolin biyosentezi, yağ asidi oksidasyonu ve yağ asidi glikoz taşıması ve lipoliz düzenlemesiyle ilişki olabileceği bildirilmektedir. Antioksidan özellikleri, siyah sarımsak polifenoller, alkaloidler, flavonoidler gibi Maillard reaksiyonunda türetilen antioksidan arayınlarına dahil olmak üzere bol miktarda antioksidan bileşik içermektedir. Wang ve San çalışmalarında siyah sarımsak etanol özütünün 200 ve 250 mikrogram bölü litre konsantrasyonuna C vitamini ile aynı DPPH radikal inhibitör etkisine sahip olduğu tespit edilmiştir. Ayrıca Lee ve arkadaşları %5 siyah sarımsak özü ile desteklenen bir diyetin oksidatif stresi ve diyabet komplikasyonlarını azalttığı ortaya konulmuştur. Siyah sarımsağın çiğ sarımsağa göre 4 kat daha yüksek ABTS radikal aktivitesi ve oksidatif stresin baskılaması yoluyla güçlü bir antioksidan kapasite olduğu vurgulanmıştır. İltihap önleyici etkisi, inflamasyon bağışık sistemimizin yaralanmaya, enfeksiyonlara ve toksinlere tepki verdiği bir süreçtir. İnflamasyon sadece yara iyileşme ve onarım sürecinde değil, aynı zamanda vücudumuzun virüsler ve bakteriler de dahil olmak üzere yabancı istilacılar da korunmada hayati bir rol oynamaktadır. Bununla birlikte kronik iltihaplanma, kalp hastalığında romatoid, artrit ve lupusa kadar çeşitli kronik rahatsızlıklar kendini gösteren sağlığımız üzerinde olumsuz etkiye sahip olabilmektedir. Son yıllarda yapılan çalışmalarda iltihaplanma ve hepsiteme ile ilgili hastalıkların tedavisinde siyah sarımsak ön plana çıkmaktadır. Siyah sarımsağın sulu özütü, nitrik oksit ve tümör nekroz faktörü dahil olmak üzere sirkülasyon üretimini engellemektedir. Zank ve Jilling yaptıkları çalışmada sulu, sıcak sulu özüt, etanol, süpernat özütü, etanol çökelti özütü, deprolize etanol süpernat özütü ve deprolize etanol çökelti özütü dahil olmak üzere 5 farklı siyah sarımsak özütünün düzenleyici etkiyi iyileştirdiği sonucu ulaşılmıştır. LPS'nin makrofaj büyüme enflasyonu etkilesine bağlı olarak azalttığı tespit edilmiştir. Nöroprotektif etkisi, siyah sarımsağın antemizik etkisi, bilimsel bozukluğun iyileştirilmesi, nöroenflasyon ve nörotoksinin yenilenmesi yoluyla hafıza ve sinir sistemi üzerine faydalı etkili olduğu bildirilmektedir. Nurmuşlu ve arkadaşlar çalışmasında siyah sarımsağın etanol özütünün çalışan bellek performansını iyileştirilmesi ve primordial nöronların nöronal mimarinin modifikasyonunu önlenmesi yoluyla monosodyum glutamat kaynaklı oksidatif stresten nörin ve medial pirotonat konsepteksi çürüşü bir şekilde koruduğu ortaya konulmuştur. Hepatoprotektif etkisi, karaciğer detoksitesi, protein sentezi ve sindirimle ilgili biyokimyasal üretim yapan hayati bir organdır. Bununla birlikte karaciğer, ilaçlar, kimyasallar, alkol, çözücüler, enfeksiyon ve besin takviyesiyle savunmasızdır. Siyah sarımsağın karaciğeri antikanser bir ilaç olan siklofosfamidin hepatoksitesi ve apoptozu gibi yan etkilerden koruduğu ortaya konulmuştur. Ahmet çalışmalarında siyah sarımsağın takviyesinin histolojik değişikliği, DNA hasarı ve kandaki biyokimyasal parametreleri değiştirdiğini ve iyileştirdiğini ve hepatik antioksidanı arttırdığı bildirilmiştir. Sonuç olarak siyah sarımsak sadece taze sarımsağın güçlü ve nahoş aromasını gidermek için değil, aynı zamanda besin bileşimini, biyoaktiflerini ve tat değerlerini iyileştirmek için düzenlenmiş yüksek nem ve sıcaklıkta fermente edilmenin iyi bilinen bir sarımsak ürünüdür. Son yıllarda piyasaya sürdükten sonra siyah sarımsak antioksidan, anti-enfotrar, anti-kanser, hiperlitreme düşürücü, anti-obezite, hepatonörolojik ve değişik fonksiyonlarla ortaya çıkan bir gıda haline gelmiştir. Biyolojik aktivite ve terapik faydaları hem intro hem in vivo düzeyde çok sayıda kapsam araştırma konusu olmuştur. Son zamanlarda siyah sarımsağın kardiyovasküler hastalıklar üzerindeki sağlığa faydalarını kanıtlayan sadece birkaç klinik çalışma vardır. Bu nedenle siyah sarımsağın terapik etki hakkında kapsamlı ve genel bakış sağlamak için siyah sarımsağın diğer tıbbi uygulama ve koruyucu özelliklerinde odaklanan daha fazla araştırma yapılması önerilmektedir. Beni dinlediğiniz için teşekkür ederim.
We thank Mr. Ömer İpek for his presentation. Now we proceed to the next presentation without any question. Next, I want to call upon Eda Alagöz to present with her presentation entitled as novel methods in used in meat tenderization.
Thank you. Sesim geliyor mu?
Evet, sesinizi alabiliyoruz Eda Hanım.
Title of my presentation is novel methods used in meat tenderization. Introduction. Quality and flavor in various meats and meat products are always at the forefront according to consumer demands and desire for it is increasing day by day. Many factors affect the tenderness of meat. These include factors such as the type, size, and age of the animal, feeding the animal before slaughter, treatment and medicines, storage conditions of the carcass after slaughter, electric shock applied to the carcass, aging of the meat, and packaging. However, the main constituent of meat tenderness are factors such as the amount and solubility of the connective tissue of the meat, the shortening of sarcomere length during rigor, and postmortem proteolysis that occurs between calpains and myofibular and their associated proteins. The traditional methods for meat tenderness have been used for many years. However, although this method provides positive contributions to the texture and flavor of the meat, it may also cause negative effects such as drip loss and cooking loss in the meat due to the long process. In recent years, many new technological methods have been applied in the industry in order to minimize the negativities that may occur with the loss of area, time, labor and energy, and to ensure more efficient and quality meat production. Changes in fresh meat by slaughter. In a few hours after slaughter, the rigor mortis naturally begins in the carcass. Rigor mortis is defined as the irreversible shortening of the muscles and they are hardening as a result of a series of chemical changes. As a result of glycolysis, glycogen turns into lactic acid in an anaerobic medium with some enzymatic activities. With the lactic acid formed, the pH begins to decrease and protein denaturation begins with the effect of acidity. When the animal is slaughtered, the tenderness is at the highest level. The tenderness decreases as the pH value decreases slowly. At the isoelectric pH reached as a result of rigor mortis at muscle, the water holding capacity and tenderness of the meat are at the lowest level. Proteolytic enzymes are also responsible for the tenderness of meat. Some of these proteolytic enzymes are enzymes that exist in the natural structure of meat, such as calpain, caspase, cathepsin. These enzymes contribute to the tenderness of meat by breaking down proteins at different pH range with the slaughter of animal. Available techniques used for meat tenderization. In order to increase tenderness, which decreases to a certain level after slaughter, techniques such as the use of exogenous enzymes, marination, salting, and electrical stimulation, as well as traditional aging can be applied. Traditional aging, it is based on the principle of keeping carcass or divide muscles in cold stores for a certain time temperature norm. In this technique, the tenderness of the meat increases slightly as a result of glycolysis, proteolytic activity, and some microbial activities. Use of exogenous enzymes. While enzymes in the natural structure of meats generally act against myofibrillar proteins, exogenous enzymes can affect both myofibrillar and connective tissue proteins. For this purpose, some plant, bacterial, and fungal proteases are used. Marinate and salting, the process of keeping the meats generally in fruit or vegetable juices with low pH for a certain time and temperature is defined as marination. When meat proteins are exposed to high acidity, they partially break down and become tenderization. Meat can be made tenderized by salting fresh meat and keeping it for a certain period of time. Electrical stimulation, it accelerates glycolysis after slaughter and in this case ensures that the meat pH reaches the isoelectric points before the muscle temperature drops sufficiently. However, it accelerates the tenderization of meat by increasing the rate of proteolysis and physically affecting muscle fibers. Novel techniques for meat tenderization. The new techniques used to make meat more tender with minimal effect on the nutritious and sensor properties of meat are as follows: high pressure processing, hydrodynamic pressure processing, pulsed electric fields, ultrasound, and smart stretch. High pressure processing is a non-head technique that increases the quality and shelf life of food products. HPP applied after slaughter increases the calcium level in the muscle and causes intense muscle contractions, resulting rapid drop in postrigor glucose and in pH. It has been reported in many studies that in addition to HPP, the application of heat increases meat tenderness. However, Radcliffe and others reported that the effect of pressure temperature application on connective tissue proteins is limited while myofibrillar proteins is affecting. The effects of HPP on meat tenderness vary depending on the rigor mortis process, pressure, temperature, and their combination. It has been reported that in many studies, high temperature application is also required with HPP for tenderizing in post-rigor process, while the low pressure application in pre-rigor process can tenderize meat. Unlike traditional applications, HPP is not affected by product and equipment size, so application time is minimized and provides convenience from laboratory findings to commercial applications. Another way to tenderizing meat by applying pressure is hydrodynamic pressure process or shock waves, which are the instantaneous development of pressure waves. Shock waves spread in liquid mediums at speeds greater than the speed of sound. Since most of the meat consists of water, the applied waves ensure tenderness by affecting the muscle proteins in the meat. The tenderness developed with the use of HPP in different time of animal meat meats varies between 5 to 75%. This change in tenderness rates depends on the use of fresh or frozen thawed meat, the specific conditions of the process, the initial tenderness, the process after slaughter and storage. It has been reported that HTP doesn't affect the color, pH, flavor components, and drip loss of fresh meat while being suitable for tenderizing meat in a short time with low cost. Pulsed electric file top application is based on the principle that the product is exposed to a certain electric field force a very short time. In addition, it differs from other traditional methods by having different parameters for each muscle. Oxidative, structural, and sensor changes on meat are minimal. Meats must be in post-mortem maturation period for PF application to have maximum effect. PF application in this process affects calcium release and calpain activation. It also affects muscles structurally, enables cathepsins to be released from lysosomes, and helps meat to become tenderizing by accelerating glycolysis. The effect of PF application on meat tenderness may vary depending on the electric field strength, the structure of the muscles, and whether the meat is in repairing period. In addition to this, it has been reported that high density applied PF may have a negative effect on meat tenderness. Ultrasound is a type of energy produced by sound waves with vibration frequency above the audible limit for humans. In ultrasound application, electrical energy is transformed into vibration energy and cavitation occurs.
Ms. Alagöz, we have 2 minutes left to the presentation.
Okay. Cavitation energy forms affects the meat chemically, physically, or biologically. Mechanical actions that occur during the ultrasound application physically affect the myofibrillar proteins in the structure of the meat. In addition, with the application of this technology, the activation of enzymes that help preparing in meat, the release of calcium into the medium, and the chemical change in the pre-rigor meat facilitates the tenderization. The effect of ultrasound application on tenderness depends on frequency, density, and application time, and the pre- or post-rigor condition of the meat. Smart stretch is a technology used to reduce hardening during rigor based on the principle of stretching the muscles, as well as the entire carcass. Only a certain number of hot-bound muscles are affected by this technology. In this technology, the hot-bound muscle is placed in a flexible shed. This shed is placed in an airtight chamber, and force is applied perpendicular to the muscle fibers. In this way, it has been reported that along with the increase of the tenderness of the meat, the water holding capacity also increases. Since the smart stretch process is not applied to the entire carcass, it provides a profit in terms of place, time, and energy, and facilitates the control of the portion shape of the meat for consumers. Conclusion. Many traditional and innovative applications are used for meat tenderizing. Meat technologies have been developed because the place, time, and energy losses in traditional processes. Technologies such as HPP and PF are more eco-friendly applications as they produce small amounts of carbon dioxide, as well as most of the new technologies designed have positive results because in their use in the industry and are also available. Because of the factors such as exist the installation cost of most of them, the need for personal training, the optimization of the working conditions of the machines, more research is required to fully bring these technologies to the industry. Thank you for listening.
We thank Mrs. Eda Alagöz for her presentation, and we proceed to the next presentation without any question. This is the last presentation in this session. For the last presentation, I want to call upon Mr. Ismail Tahran to present with his presentation entitled as Investigation of the Tocopherol Composition of Commercial Fish Oil.
Yeah, thank you so much. Hi, my name is Ismail Tarhan, and I am from Selçuk University, Faculty of Science, Department of Biochemistry. And I'm going to show my presentation is titled Investigation of Tocopherol Compositions of Commercial Fish Oils. And this is my outline. Firstly, I'm going to talk about the fish oils and then studies performed in the framework of the research. And the last one, acknowledgments and references. Yeah, the edible oils are divided in three main categories, and these are animal fats, vegetable oils, and fish oils. Actually, fish oils are also in the same category in animal fats, but it's differentiated with high omega-3 content in fish oils. And edible oils constitute the most concentrated source of energy among the compounds that make the foodstuffs. And also, edible oils are esters of glycerol and carboxylic acids. And the compounds of fish oils are divided into main two categories. These are major compounds and minor compounds. Major compounds is triglycerides, and the minor compounds are free fat acids, means FFA, mono and diglycerides, and hydrocarbons, means squalene, sterols, aliphatic alcohols, tocopherols, and pigments. And also the analysis of adulterations and classification are made with the help of these components, minor compounds. And why are edible oils is important? For this one, it constitutes the most concentrated source in terms of energy, and they act as a carriers for fat-soluble vitamins. These are A, D, E, K, and they contain various fat acids with essential qualities. They are involved in the structure of cell membranes. They are used for heating and food preservation, and they take part in adjusting body temperature and creating energy stores. And it is used for multiple purposes because it adds flavor to foods. And it is different from many oils because include one of the most important omega-3 long-chain polyunsaturated fat acids, means PUFAs in hygromons. These are eicosapentaenoic acid and docosahexaenoic acid, and having beneficial effects on human health. For these reasons, it's a commercially valuable oil. And the importance of tocopherol composition for the fish oil, it's important because an essential fat-soluble antioxidant, the tocopherols, and lipoprotein function in cell membranes, and tocopherols has an effect on nervous system and muscular system, and they are endocrine glands and reproduction, and we know the most famous alpha tocopherol as vitamin E. And the second one, studies performed in the framework of the research. In this study, we 20 fish oils in different brands were obtained from the local markets in Turkey. And for the determination of tocopherol compounds amounts in fish oil, standard CA methods of IOCS modified by Ageland was used. And approximately 0.2 gram of the sample to be analyzed taken in a suitable and plain tube according to the related method was weighted and dissolved in 1000 milliliters of N-heptan and then filtered and cupped glass vials with a volume of 1.5 milliliter ready for analysis. And in analysis, we used the Ageland HPLC system with fluorescence detector. And this is my chromatographic conditions. In this study, my column was a technochromal chromosphere diol column. And my mobile phase was a N-heptan and tertiary butyl methyl ether. And my flow rate was 1 milliliter person minute. And my deduction was fluorescence, and analysis time was 45 minutes, and my injection was 10 microliters, and my temperature, column temperature was 35 centigrade. And for the calibration, for determination of tocopherol amount, and we prepared standard tocopherol solutions. These are containing alpha, beta, gamma, and sigma tocopherols, with ranging different concentrations. And after that, we injected the our HPLC system according to parameters in the above table. And the peak areas and known concentrations of the tocopherol compounds were taken into account while creating the calibration plots. The amount of tocopherol was automatically calculated by the HPLC software by taking into account the peak areas in the chromatograms obtained as the results of analysis of the samples to be determined and using the calibration pipe. And this is an example of my studies. This figure shows the chromatogram of the tocopherol composition of the, one of them, my sample. It's MO11 sample. And as you can see, we successfully determined the all tocopherol composition in MO11 sample. And the first one is alpha tocopherol, as you can see, and the second one is beta, and third one is gamma, and the last one was the sigma tocopherol composition. And the discussion section. According to analysis made for determination of the tocopherol composition of all my marine oil fish oil samples, most of the marine oil samples were determined with the current standard analysis methods. And in total, the highest tocopherol ratio was obtained from the MO11 sample with 881 milligram per kilogram oil. And the lowest ratio was obtained from the MO3 sample with 32 milligram per kilogram oil. And no tocopherol spaces, unfortunately, could be detected in the some marine oil samples, fish oil samples. These are, for example, 2, 5, 6, 7, 8, 19, and etc. And it was observed that the samples examined within the scope of the study mainly contained alpha and beta tocopherol. And all tocopherol spaces were found only in MO11 and MO12 samples. And the last determined type of the tocopherol was sigma tocopherol. And according to the results obtained, it was determined that the fish oil food supplements sold in the markets of our country and bought and consumed by consumers are rich in vitamin E, as well as their high omega-3 ratios. Thank you for your attention. And if you have a question, you can write my email address. Thank you.
We thank Mr. Ismail Tahran for his presentation. And this session is over right now. I want to thank all presenters to make valuable contribution to the Congress. And I wish you have a successful Congress. If you have any question, please write on, please direct it by using WhatsApp to the organizing committee. They will direct it to the presenter, and you can get answers from directly the presenters. Thank you again for your attention.
Thank you too.
mısınız?
Çekmez hocam, hoş geldiniz. Sesimi alabilir.